Panel with us today. A lot of common threads. One common thread. We have members, former members of the Judiciary, and we have also the people who help select people for judicial nominations. So we have that common thread, and probably the larger thread we have is that we just have four very smart people on the panel. So we're going to move around with some questions on judicial selection and process, and we're going to digress in a few areas too, just to take advantage of the great minds that we have on our panel. We're going to do something a little different on questions. If you have a question that is directly related to the conversation, stand up or raise your hand. We'll make discussion interactive, but please make your question brief and again on point. If you have a question that's not on point, that's okay, but we'll save some time at the end for those questions. So our guests today are Presiding Justice Harold Melton, our next Chief Justice. Of course, the former executive counsel to Governor Sonny Perdue, and in that role, a close advisor to the governor on many issues, water, litigation, and of course, presumably the courts and judicial things as well. He also brings a perspective that I think is probably unique among justices, and he has many, many years of experience in the state law department. Justice Leah Ward Sears has achieved many firsts in her career. First woman to serve on the Fulton Superior Court, first woman and youngest person on the Georgia Supreme Court, twice on the President's shortlist for a U.S. Supreme Court post, and now a partner at Smith, Gambrell, and Russell. Robert Highsmith, also a former executive counsel to Governor Sonny Perdue, who practices at Holland & Knight, where he is executive partner in the Atlanta office. And he's practices in public policy and government relations, regulatory affairs, and leads the state capitol and Georgia government relations practice. He serves on the Judicial Nominating Commission as an appointee of Governor Deal, and also served on the JNC under Governor Perdue. None of that holds a candle to his most impressive accomplishment, which is jumping into the tank with the sharks at the Georgia Aquarium. Buddy Darden has long swam with the sharks in the fish tank they call politics. It's much more dangerous. Buddy is a former Cobb County District Attorney, member of the Georgia House, and spent more than a decade in Congress and the U.S. House. As a congressman, he managed to earn below 50% ratings from both liberal and conservative rating agencies, which I guess qualifies him as an independent thinker. I'm still trying to figure out that math, however. He also served on the GNC as an appointment of Governor Boyd Barnes, and he headed the committee that made recommendations to President Obama on federal judicial posts in Georgia. He recently moved his practice from Dentons to Pope Glamour. I'm going to pick up on a question, if you'll indulge us a bit. We just had a really interesting session with Bill Nygut, where the first half hour was spent talking about guns. And the sense of the panel was that we may have reached some sort of turning point in the public perspective or willingness to take certain actions. And I know this is not directly related to our plan discussion, it's a little bit of a curveball, but I know that all of you have extensive experience in government and policy and just dealing with people in general. So I'm going to, just for a moment, digress on it. I know Justice Melton, of course, can't comment on anything that might come before the court, but I also know that you work extensively with younger people, and younger people tend to be both perpetrators and victims. And then the shootings, we see, perhaps you have some perspective on that. Buddy, we'll start with you. You were in Congress when the Clinton assault weapons ban was up for a vote. So you've kind of seen this issue play out over a period of years. Any thoughts on whether we are at indeed a turning point or just another cable TV news moment?
Well, Ed, I earned my PhD in gun legislation during the first 2 years of the Clinton administration. We had some pretty hotly contested bills to come up. Not only did we have the assault weapon matter to come up, we also had the Brady bill. I voted for the Brady bill, much to the chagrin and disappointment of a lot of my constituents up in Northwest Georgia. But the assault weapon ban was a little more difficult for me. An overwhelming number of my constituents opposed it. And so I voted originally not to include it in the crime bill. However, the crime bill did include the assault weapons ban. So in typical political fashion, I turned around and voted for the bill, which included the assault weapons provision. And of course, some people say I paid dearly for it. I don't think so. I think it was the right thing to do. And that ban stayed in effect, I think, for almost 10 years before it expired.
So are we at a turning point?
I believe we are at a point in which we are finally having a serious discussion. Whether or not it will be a turning point, I don't know. But by the fact that Governor Rick Scott, who is a Republican governor of Florida and a potential and probable candidate for Senate in Florida, now has a gun package for the Florida legislature to consider, and they'll be out of session by the 9th of March. That includes that some type of turning point is happening, at least in Florida, and it might spread to other states. However, I'm a little skeptical here, because when the Newtown killings happened, and at Sandy Hook Elementary School up in Connecticut, when that didn't change things, it was hard for me to imagine that anything else could ever do it. When those poor innocent children were killed in elementary school, that didn't do it. I'm not sure that this will do it. So I'll have to see more evidence before I believe that we're at a turning point.
Can I add to that? I have to agree that I was never in a policy-making position like that, spending the vast majority of my professional career on the bench. I didn't think in terms of policy quite like that. But it just, just speaking as a mother and a good citizen and wife and all of that, nothing seems to change. If it didn't change because of Sandy Hook, I can't see that it would change. Now, I think at some point something's going to change, but I don't have any hope that this is a turning point or anything else other than what's going on in the past.
I don't envy our judges in the wake of these shootings. I have a niece that teaches high school very near Parkland. I was teaching a college seminar 30 miles from Sandy Hook when it happened. Newtown, obviously horrible tragedies. And I do think that we're at a turning point in terms of the public discourse. Ed, my hope is that discourse focuses on the political solutions that are available when majorities large enough seek to make change. one of our former Supreme Court justices, I'm not going to say which because I'm not sure which, said that he thought that the founders probably intended us to amend our Constitution more frequently than we do. And there's a political solution to Heller. If you don't like Heller, there's a political solution to it, and it's to amend the United States Constitution. I found it very intellectually honest of Justice Stevens when he said, when he proposed the text of an amendment to the Constitution that would supersede Heller and eliminate the individual right to bear arms. But the reason I started my comments by saying that I don't envy our judges is that the Bill of Rights is frequently, it was intended to be counter-majoritarian, and it was intended to be politically inconvenient, and no more, no more do we see that than now. And so I do believe that perhaps a serious conversation can be had if it is the will of the people to pursue a political remedy, and I don't envy our judges when they are urged to pursue a legal remedy when the Supreme Court has said what it said about the individual right to bear arms.
Justice Melton? No, I'm just kidding.
I'll pass.
Yeah. Okay.
I would have been a lot later than 10 minutes if I'd known that was going to be the first question.
Okay, we will get on topic. Justice Melton, it's a bigger court than in 2005 when you came on board. Has it made any qualitative difference in the decisions and the processes? And of course, we have to acknowledge that there was some political motivation, some say, in the expansion of the court to place more conservative justices on the court. Has there been any change in the direction of the balance of the court's opinions?
I guess every question will have a policy angle to it that I will work steadfastly to stay away from. But the court has changed dramatically. I was pleased to join the court under Chief Justice Sears Watts, and I always take the opportunity to thank her for bringing me in and welcoming me and looking out after me, which she did. But the court has changed since then, and one of the differences is that when you go from 7 to 9 justices, you go from 7 justices deciding every case to 9 justices deciding every case. And so you don't necessarily speed up the process, but you definitely get a more careful and critical eye. The credentials of our new justices are astounding. I don't want to say anything about the court as it existed other than say these justices surpass my credentials by far. I was someone who maybe read a law review article. Now I'm debating law with folks who not only wrote law review articles but were editors themselves, and I see their editorial skills quite a bit now when I try to get an opinion out the door. I've also noticed that our page count has gone up. Y'all have probably noticed our page count has gone up. I was looking on my computer screen the other day, and Justice Boggs walked in, and he said, "What are you doing?" I said, "I'm having page envy right now." I said, "Well," he said, "What do you mean?" I said, "I'm looking at this opinion from just 15 years ago out of our court, and it's one page." And I was just drooling over it. With the idea that if we could ever get our current opinions down to one page, it'd be great, because I think I enjoyed the, as a practitioner, I enjoyed the get in, get out approach with the opinions. You get it, open it up, see what it says, take what you need, and you move on to the next case. But our opinions are extremely well thought out. They're very thorough in the analysis. And from that standpoint, I think the thought process is clear. Our hands are above the table in terms of what we're doing and how we're doing it. And so the product is very consistent. And because of that, what you found is, even though we have 9 now instead of 7, we're 98%, probably 99% unanimous in our opinions. And it's rare that we even have a concurrence or a special concurrence. So I think overall, we're better than we've ever been.
Justice Sears, I think you were undecided on the expansion of the court. Any thoughts on that now?
I when I was on the court, and I guess things have changed, I didn't see where there was a need for additional personnel. It seemed that we were managing fairly well, and I know when I was on the court, that's been some time ago now, there was a lot of brevity, and keeping it short and keeping it understandable was a quality that a lot of the justices were going for. And I'm not sure now as a practitioner on the outside, even though it's obvious that the opinions are longer, I'm not sure they're crisper or better understood. So, and that's not to take away at all from what's going on the court. I think the new justices are fine, doing well, and it's a well-run court, okay? Those are my thoughts.
Okay. Can I add to that? A couple of things that have happened as well. We've begun to try to tell the story of the Supreme Court and how busy we are as a court. And I know the chief can relate to that. Even under her watch, we are one of the busiest courts in the country. And we haven't made that case because we really didn't know. But we've now had two studies that can have confirmed that. One out of, I won't name states, I'll forget them. But they've confirmed that we've led the country for some time in terms of the number of opinions that we put out, the number of days that we hear oral arguments, the quickness with which we get opinions out the door, and none of this is new. But in addition to that, we as a court are the governing body of the judiciary as a whole, and we spend an awful lot of time with judicial functions in terms of governance, with all the classes of court, working with the judicial council. We had a judicial council meeting this morning, all the legislative committees, liaison with the bar committees, and there are innumerable organizations that we work with. So we stay busy. So the rationale for the additional justices, putting aside whatever motives might otherwise exist, you do have two additional judges to write opinions, but you especially have two other judges to divide up the administrative roles that exist out there.
And I want to add, and I don't think most lawyers really understand how bogged down justices get with all of the administrative functions. It is quite heavy. When I took over as Chief Justice, there were commissions and councils coming out of the wall. I never knew you're about to see that I never even heard of before. And it's a lot to manage. So I can definitely see the help.
I want to tell a story on Justice Melton we both left Governor Hughes' office at roughly the same time, me to reenter private practice and Harold to go on the court. And very shortly after his appointment, trying to help him understand, what he needed to do next. Well, it was in the spring and the bar conference was coming up. And I'll never forget, I was standing in the governor's office in the Capitol, and everybody had lots of advice for the new justice. And, Harold, you got to get down to the bar meeting. You got to be seen, meet everybody, and, be recognized by the bar. And what reminded me of this is when he said, can I add something to that? And I just sort of chuckled because, who in this room would tell the justice that he couldn't add something to anything? But he looked at me dead serious and says, I can't do that. I said, why not? And he said, well, I've missed the registration deadline. That's a true story. We got him down there. I pointed him to some relevant provisions of the organic documents of the state bar of Georgia that helped him understand his role. Another quick vignette. I played a very, very, very small role in the court expansion. It was this. In 2004, Mike Bowers was the chair of Governor Perdue's Judicial Nominating Commission, the commission that nominated Justice Melton. And if you're a counsel to a governor, you spend a lot of time in parts of the code that other folks don't ever really look at. You're deep in Title 45, looking at obscure stuff that nobody else cares about. You're and I was just leafing through the And it was not widely appreciated at the time, but the Constitution, and I didn't realize it, that the Constitution for decades has said the Georgia Supreme Court shall consist of not more than 9 justices. It goes back, I think, at least to the 83 Constitution, maybe before. Those that were following more closely than I may have known that. But Mike Bowers wanders in my office, and I'm staring at this page, and look, you know, I'm having to peel the page apart. It's probably the first time that this particular page has actually been opened on the spine of this book. Mike Bowers walked in, and I didn't even greet him. I just turned the book around, and I pushed it across my desk. And he looks at it. Well, I'll be damned. So began the effort to expand the court, because that meant you only needed 91 votes in the House and 29 votes in the Senate. You didn't need a vote of the people, you didn't need supermajorities. So anyway, yeah, that's the role I played in.
Today I'm proudly wearing the pin of the Supreme Court of Georgia, which was given to me just last week by my good friend, Chief Justice Harris Hines, whom I've known since he was a trial judge and I was district attorney up in Cobb. And I've known personally every member of the Supreme Court, fortunately, of the last 50 years, because this coming 50 years, on May the 10th, I will have been a member of the Georgia Bar for 50 years. I was sworn in, by the way, by the Honorable Connelly Ingram, former Supreme Court Justice, whom I talked to 30 minutes a day about this program, and also had lunch with Norman Underwood, who was my predecessor with Governor Miller. And having said that, I've got the greatest respect for the courts, and in particular the trial courts, as well as the appellate courts. But in all candor, I think the 9-member court has got to prove itself. And with all respect to our members of the court, I've never known an appellate judge who was not overworked or underpaid. And there is quite a bit of skepticism among members of the bar about the expansion of the court. And I think we're going to be watching it pretty carefully. Now, I'm out of the picture. I'm not going to be up there with any cases or anything like that. So I can't do any damage. But at the same time, not only has the court, Justice Melton, expanded by itself by 2 members, but you've given away all of this troublesome jurisdiction to the Court of Appeals, who claim that they're the busiest court in the nation. So I guess we'll just have to wait and see where it goes. But there's frankly, and this is no disrespect intended, there's a lot of skepticism out here among the bar about this new experiment. And I hope it works, and I'll do my best to support that it does work. However, you need to know that this is not the most popular thing. Everybody will tell you, you know, these folks, judges, you know, judges here, oh, it's a wonderful thing y'all are doing over there. Oh, this is just great. But this is, I think, if you will pardon the expression, the jury's out on the 9-member court.
Well, that's what you get when you get a senior lawyer on this panel. And I respect that, Congressman. So let me give you a couple of stats here, just to, so you have some idea where we are. It had the jurisdictional shift, so the divorce cases, so you didn't need 9 judges saying that the worksheet was off by $25. You sent it to a panel. Divorce cases, title to land, equity cases went to the Court of Appeals. So the thought would be that our caseload would go down. Well, it didn't. Unexpectedly, our murder cases have skyrocketed, and we don't know why. And so our cases are actually up from previous years and where we were before. But with the jurisdictional shift, our cert cases that we've granted are up 30%. So we're hearing more certs, which is really how we should be. You don't want 9 judges doing math on the worksheet. We want 9 judges determining questions where there's real gravity. So that's where we are. We'll continue to try to earn your trust going forward.
Robert, Governor Deal has had an unprecedented number of appointments to the courts, often getting an additional appointment by moving someone in the trial court up and then filling that position as well. You, of course, have been one of the architects of that effort and recommending nominees to the governor. So I don't expect completely unbiased your point here, but what is the governor's legacy going to be?
Well, let me first say, disclaim any architectural role. I mean, at best, I'm a drywall hanger. I am very proud of the small role that I've played on both Governor Perdue's Judicial Nominating Commission and Governor Deal's in nominating quality candidates to the governor to be appointed. And I think that Governor Deal's done an absolutely fantastic job in populating our courts with outstanding judges. And I think that there's perhaps no better testament to that than we now have two sitting justices of our Supreme Court who are on, and you can quibble with the president and how he does things, but what he's decided to do is to have a list, say, look, next time I get to pick a judge, it's going to be off of this list. Well, two of our state Supreme Court justices are on that list. That is as good a testament as I can think of to the quality of judges that Governor Deal has appointed. I'm absolutely, I mean, Ed, you're right, I am biased, and I'm proud of the role that was the small drywall hanger, journeyman, tradesman role that I've had in that.
Well, surprisingly, I'm going to agree with Robert Highsmith here, because I think one of the bright spots of the Deal administration has been his appointment. He's a lawyer. He was a good lawyer before he went to Congress. We served in Congress together as Democrats, by the way. And he has brought, I think, his respect for the court and respect for the bar to the governorship, and has made generally excellent appointments. Maybe it's not the appointments that you or I would have made, but he earned the right to make those appointments by being elected governor. So I think his legacy, one of his strongest legacies, will be his contribution to the bench of the state of Georgia. In contrast, as a lawyer, and in all deference to Governor Perdue, Governor Deal is a lawyer and likes lawyers. And I think the only lawyer that Governor Perdue liked was Justice Melton. He didn't have the same feeling, Justice Melton. You'll have to agree to his lawyers
that's a much longer conversation.
In all candor, I think this will be this one of the strongest parts of his legacy. And I commend Robert Highsmith and others who filled in that role.
All right. Well, I just got to jump in. The people who have been appointed are qualified, no question about that, but I have been pretty vocal about the lack of diversity among all of the appointments. So the vast majority are white men, continues that. I think when I served on the Supreme Court, it was more diverse than it is now with 9 members. The Court of Appeals, pretty much the same. I mean, Fulton County, DeKalb County, and maybe Cobb have some people of color, but throughout the state, I think it's been devastating. And I think that's not something really to celebrate. I don't have the stats with me, and I think you said you might bring those, but it's not a good thing. I think in the state, 70% to 80% of the judges are white male, but that white men aren't 70 or 80% of the population of Georgia. And that really creates a distrust by many, many Georgians when they go to court and see people that can't find people that look like them.
One easy stat, come September, it looks like we will be down to one woman on the court. Justice Melton, is that a problem?
Which court, our court?
Yes.
Come September, we don't know the answer to that because there will be an appointment to fill a vacancy. Given our numbers, your percentages vary wildly. I like diversity. I will take as much diversity as we can get. And so if I have a choice, that's where I would land. But I don't know if it'll be a problem in September or not.
Take us behind the closed doors of the Judicial nominated Commissioner Robert. What kind of conversations have you had about diversity?
You know, I spoke, some of you may have been there, I believe Justice Sears was, I know Justice Melton was. I spoke at the bar meeting on Amelia in 2014 to a fairly hostile audience on that topic, and I certainly understand the concern. We're not recruiters in the sense that we're spending active time on the JNC, but we do, you know, we're trying to increase the pipeline. I think it's too easy and too glib an answer, Justice Sears, to say, well, there weren't enough that applied. That's an easy, and it's frequently true, but it can't be the end of the answer. I've been on the Judicial Nominating Commission since 2005, I believe, that there is always a desire to have as diverse a slate of nominees as possible to go forward. And we can quibble about the statistics and the numbers that were put forward, but I'm proud of having participated in Justice Melton's nomination. The judges that Justice Sears mentioned, particularly in the metro area, where I do think we have had a good run. I mean, Judge Ross, who, you know, as soon as, you know, she'd been on the bench about 10 minutes before the president elevated her, helping his diversity statistics and hurting ours. There are several that we're, you know, very proud of having, you know, begun to have elevated. And I think that on the appellate courts, it won't happen overnight, but a great many of the judges at the trial court level, which, Ed, as you note, is where particularly this governor and a lot of governors choose to elevate judges to the appellate courts, the more and more trial judges that get appointed, particularly in jurisdictions like Fulton DeKalb, that hear a lot of the bigger cases and get broader experience, will make that pool, that pipeline, broader and more, and have more diverse candidates available to be appointed. It's what I said in 2014 is still true. The work's never done. You can never sit back and rest on your laurels and say, well, we appointed two or three, and that'll be good enough. And we all adopted, diversity is a goal for which we should always all continue to strive. It is hard, and the selective pool of candidates from which you can draw makes it hard as well, because the bar itself is less reflective of the population at large in terms of who you can draw from. So we just have to keep working at it. I know I'm committed to it, as I've said publicly in writings and Ed, when you were running the paper, and it's just something we have to keep working at. But I can say this: in 10 years, I've certainly never heard any hostility to the notion of a diverse bench expressed. If anything, there's a desire to continue pressing forward with it, and a frustration sometimes that we're not able to because of the pool of candidates that's before us.
Can I just add this? I just thank you and I appreciate it. I just don't think it really is that esoteric or hard. If you want a diverse pool of candidates, you just affirm it. Thank
you. And let me shed a little insight that we had when I was chairman of the ANC for the Barnes administration, and also when we did the federal recommendation, and that is this: you have so many good candidates in front of you, and what you've got to avoid, in my opinion, and what I always tried to avoid, and unfortunately got to be known, as the Darden rule, with some bit of skepticism when I was chair in both times. But you've got to present, in my view, a diverse panel and give the governor a number of choices. Now, whoever the governor appoints, that's his or her business, or the president, the same way. But you've got to avoid, in your list that you send to the governor or to the president, twins or triplets. In other words, if you've got two assistant DAs, two assistant U.S. attorneys, both sitting next to each other in the U.S. attorney's office in Macon, for example, you've got to choose between one of them. You don't want to send twins up, or you don't want to send three white males from private practice from UNW. What you've got to do is give the appointing authority a variety of choices, and then once that appointing authority makes its decision, then that is the judge. But I think it's incumbent upon the JNC and the screening committees to provide to the appointing authority a diverse panel, and if the appointing authority sees fit not to follow, so be it. But that's the most difficult challenge we have, I think, as people such as Robert, who serve on the committee, is to try to find a diverse panel to send up, because if you don't send up a diverse panel, you're not going to, of course, get into diversity on the bench.
I mean, let me just add, Justice Melton wasn't in the judicial pipeline. He's doing okay. He's going to be our next Chief Justice. So that's not that is not necessarily a prerequisite, unless you put it in your head. It's seemingly like a way to talk to me. And I'm not trying to appear hostile.
No, but I, you know, what I said about Justice Melton was that I was proud of having participated in his appointment, I used to, when I would get asked these questions, I would, you know, list, you know, do a representative list of the diverse judges in whose nomination I participated, and that was not always well received, and there's one reason for that is this. I mentioned in my first comments that there's a political remedy for Heller. Well, there's also there has to be nominees who share the judicial philosophy of the appointing authority, and that is a limiting factor across all categories of diversity. It can be. You have to if you accept that an appointing authority is going to appoint judges that share their judicial philosophy, which in the case of Governor Deal is a conservative one, then that further limits the pool. And that's not to take away from what Congressman Darden said, that I agree with 1,000%. It's incumbent on us to present as diverse a slate of nominees as possible. And that is the political reality of having a conservative government.
Well, with all due respect, we didn't look at judicial philosophy, and I don't think that is necessarily should be some type of litmus test. I think the person's education, the person's temperament, the person's experience, life experience, to me is so important. That's one of the things that I dwell upon quite a bit. But once a person is what I call presumptively qualified, that is, they're honest and trustworthy, that they meet the educational requirements and intellectually qualified to be on the bench, and are people who have the correct judicial temperament, I think that is so important. And then philosophy was of no really concern to us in our case. I just don't believe that in judicial philosophy, because a judge, once that judge gets on the bench, it's not philosophy that counts. It's how they conduct themselves and how hard they work. Yeah,
the judicial philosophy thing is new. That wasn't how it used to be. I know when I was appointed by Zell Miller, there was never any question about what my judicial philosophy would, or whether I was close to his or not. It was whether I was competent, whether I was honest, whether I could do a good job. That wasn't a consideration at all. So this is a new thing.
Robert, there's a forum on diversity at Dentons recently, actually, by the moderator. Your colleague on the JNC, Randy Evans, the ambassador, Randy Evans, said that he has repeatedly asked Black, Latino, and women attorneys to apply for judgeships and been turned down because they don't want to take a cut in pay. Have you found that to be true?
So, gun control and defending Randy Evans, that was not in the email.
That's tough.
Randy's my dear friend. I mean, look, I'm unaware of any, using the qualifications with which I completely agree from both Justice Sears has articulated as well as Congressman Darden. I'm unaware, and feel free to challenge me on this, I'm unaware of any qualified, diverse applicant that our committee has failed to nominate. Now, you know, the appointments, that's a political question for the governor, as Congressman Darden notes. You know, and I've certainly never been part of the conversation, well, this person's qualified, but they're not conservative enough, so we're not going to nominate him. It's just never happened. In terms of urging people to apply there, it's certainly true, Ed, that there are highly successful diverse lawyers who don't want to enter public service, just like they are highly successful non-diverse lawyers who don't want to enter public service. That's something I think cuts across. And I don't know specifically who Randy might have spoken to in that regard, but it's not been my observation that diverse lawyers are more likely to decline a judicial opportunity than non-diverse lawyers because of their success in private practice. That's just, you know, my observation. And again, the judges the diverse judge, and I think of Judge Wong, my section mate at the University of Georgia Law School, the first Asian American female in the Southeast to go on the bench. You know, she left a partnership at Sutherland to join the state court bench in Fayette County. Entering the pipeline, not to use a dirty word, but then moved up. So that I it's not been my observation, but I certainly wouldn't, if that's been Randy's, then you know he's. And that's been Randy.
You get a decent salary as a judge. You can get along. That's a joke. I mean, you really can get along. It's a decent salary. It's respectable.
Please correct me if I'm wrong. I believe the last two justices named from private practice were named by Governor Joe Frank Harris. I know of course, Bob Benham, former Chief Justice Benham, and former Chief Justice Norman Fletcher. Now, as I recall, both of them were in private practice and not in government, and were not in any. I'll take that back. Justice Benham came from the Court of Appeals. From which he had been appointed from private practice.
Justice Blackwell.
That's right.
Yes, thanks for reminding me about that. I'm always pleased, by the way, and this is no disrespect intended toward any persons of courts left lower than the Supreme Court, but I'm always pleased to see people taken out, lawyers taken out by the private practice who enter judgeship. And I think we probably, looking back on it, we always tried to put at least one, even though Governor Barnes in most cases didn't accept them. I always like to have somebody from private practice, practicing lawyer, somebody who's come to court, been kicked around a little bit, and jacked around a little bit by this judge or that judge. It's kind of good for them also to be considered for the bench.
Buddy, going back to that forum, Dentons, of which you moderated with Randy Evans. I believe at the time you disagreed with Randy on the difficulty of finding judges or judicial nominees. And the sense of your reply was that maybe we don't need to set the bar so high. We need the highest paid or most elite lawyers. I believe, I think you said it's not brain surgery.
Oh, you mean Robert? We're talking about Randy.
Yeah, when I think you replied to Randy and you were disagreeing with the difficulty in finding judges because of the pay.
So let me, Ed, so Randy was saying, let's lower the bar?
No, I believe that you were throwing that into discussion.
You'll have to be a little more specific about the time and place.
I think your position was that maybe
when and where are we talking about?
The Dentons Diversity Forum. Well, that's okay. I guess, you know, the overall question is, let me just shift back to a few years ago when you were the drywall hanger for Governor Barnes.
Right.
The JNC.
I was never, incidentally, I never had any official position with the Barnes administration. I was merely a private practitioner.
Right. But you were on the JMC, though.
Yeah, I was chair of the JMC.
So do you think the process has changed a lot since then? We talked about asking about judicial philosophy, diversity. I know you're not inside the JNC now, but from what you're seeing, is that process changed?
Well, what you said is the key to it. I'm not inside the JNC now, and I'm certainly not in a position to criticize anything they do, because I believe in the power of the executive to fill these positions. And in all candor, I think we need to step back just a second and say what's good about our system in Georgia. I think we probably have the best system of filling judicial vacancies of any state I know. Look at all the fights they have and the partisan judges in Alabama and Texas. I was in Michigan several years ago during elections, and some of the ads that they were coming out with about who sent more people to the chair than others, things like that, were quite unseemly. So I think we need to step back just a second. And I'm starting off with the proposition that we probably have the best selection system, certainly in the Southeast, if not, it certainly compares favorably with the nation. Now, having said that, that doesn't mean that it can improve. But at the same time, the Governor Nathan Deal was elected, and he won the right to make these appointments, and he has the right to run the process. Now, we expanded when I came on. It was just a little small group of, in all fairness, elite five or six lawyers had been to JMC before Dell Miller. Dell Miller came in and expanded it, and to include people with wider experience. And then we enlarged when Governor Barnes came in. We enlarged on the diversity and the number of people on the commission, started doing it by panel. So I think we continue to improve it, but that doesn't mean it could not be improved more. But in all fairness to Robert and the commission, as it is now under Governor Deal, he's earned the right to make those decisions, and I don't know enough about what goes on internally within their JNC to comment one way or another. I think that would be out of my purview of understanding.
We said we'd open up the session for questions. Do we have any questions? You don't often get to ask a Supreme Court justice the question, usually it goes the other way. Way back here.
No.
Okay. What I would know.
What was the question?
Do you have to be a member of the Federalist Society to be appointed a judge in Georgia?
Well, I would note that the last three appointments to the Supreme Court, they were members of the Federalist Society. I'm sure that's a coincidence, but that did occur.
Injecting a certain amount of partisanship into that whole issue?
What I mean by judicial philosophy, I'm just speaking only for myself, what I mean by judicial philosophy is does not go to policy issues, and it's not a euphemism for conservative policy preferences. It is a you know, what I view as a conservative, as a judicial philosophy is very similar, I think, to how Buddy would describe his definition of judicial restraint, and it, I mean judicial temperament, which is restraint, respect for the separation of powers, a reluctance to make law except where necessary, and just, you know, just an approach to judging that follows those precepts, respect for democratic processes, and a willingness to make politically unpopular decision where counter-majoritarian provisions of the state or federal constitutions call for it. I don't think I would be out of turn by quoting one of our Court of Appeals judges when asked, because I believe he's given this answer when asked many times about his own personal philosophy about the death penalty. And his answer was, I'm a devout Roman Catholic. It's against my church teaching. My personal philosophy is against the death penalty. I don't believe that we should sit in judgment of men and women and decide whether they should be put to death. But today, the death penalty is the law of the land, and if a trial judge imposes it in an appropriate case, and if the law supports it, I'm going to uphold it. That's the sort of judicial philosophy question that we look to. It's not a euphemism for partisanship, and it's not a euphemism for policy preference.
We have time for one more question. It's quick. Panel, thank you.
Thank you.
Stage and go to our last panel as soon as we can get it set up.
Wait, you know what? If you're on